You're watching Drakewing Gaming. Enjoy the video.
Hey guys, Nary here from Drakewing Gaming. Some of you know me on Twitter, The Gaming Dragon. Today I'm coming back at you in another Let's Play episode of Temptation's Ballad. So guys, let's go ahead and jump right back into it. We just unleashed the demon Malice, and turns out he's a cute little snoot booper. He's adorable. Let's stretch him out some more. Anyway, guys, let's jump right back into it. Please sit back and enjoy for the next 18 minutes to entertain you. Let's jump right in. Alarm sign, you're up, and let's go. All right. Your emotions will feed us and become a wonderful source of infernal energy. Speaking of which, you, tiny mortal, you will form a pact with me. As a temptation demon, a conflicted mess of a person like you will make the perfect host for me. With you at my beck and call, I shall return to my true form in no time. No thanks. I don't make deals with shady talking noobs. But I can grant you power, fame, glory. You wish to gain the approval of your father, do you not? With my help.
Yeah, I don't think Papa would be very impressed if I grew strong from demon magic. Anyway, time to squish you. Please tell me you turn back into a ruby after you die. I was hoping to pawn a decent price off that gem.
Cole reached for a nearby butter knife.
Wait!
Malice immediately shrieked and his eyes flashed a blinding red. Acrid wisps of infernal magic shot across the room. Cole winced as a flicker of heat reverberated through his chest. It felt as though he'd been smacked with a hot water bottle.
The hell was that?
We are now connected, puny mortal. Any harm or sensation one of us feels, the other shall feel as well, and that includes pain. You shan't get rid of me so easily.
Cole scowled and gave the snake an experimental pinch. Sure enough, he felt a light pinch squeeze his own shoulder. He let out a frustrated groan and fell back onto his hammock.
Ugh, talk about a raw deal! I just wanted a gem, not a snake babysitting job.
You are stuck with me forever now, rest assured. Sooner or later, I shall tempt you into a contract with me. Just you wait.
A sharp chime suddenly echoed outside, ringing throughout the entire city. As usual, the Axia clock tower struck on the hour as the city's public timekeeping system. Cole counted the number of chimes and nearly leapt out of his bed in sudden realization.
It's 9 o'clock already! I was supposed to meet up with Sid at the town square! Damn it, why did you have to prattle on for so long?
Nah, you have places to be? Excellent! I have always wanted to explore the material plane and all of its exciting riches. You will make an excellent host and tour guide, tiny puny mortal.
Cole yelped as the python casually slithered into his belt pocket.
Wow, it's surprisingly roomy in here.
Don't just slide into other people's pants without asking.
You can't tell me what to do, puny mortal. Now, to this town square, post haste.
Cole groaned for what felt like the umpteenth time that morning as he dragged himself out of bed.
What a bossy little shit.
Everyone's just like we're walking around. Town square. Alright, what do we got in the town square? Ah, a miniature set. From someone's D&D campaign. That's what it looks like. The morning sun felt pleasantly warm against his fur as Cole leisurely strolled across the city of Axia. His new snake companion was enthusiastically chatty as he rode on Cole's shoulder, asking questions about everything it saw. It truly felt as though he was leading an awestruck tourist through town as he not so patiently answered each little python's inquiries. Their conversation trailed somewhere along the lines of, "Yes, that's a restaurant. People eat food there. Have you never eaten before?"
"Yeah, people need to eat food and drink water to not drop dead."
"No, I've never died before. How the fuck do you think I'm still standing here?" As the two of them rounded a corner at the town square proper, Malice marveled at the crowd of villagers strolling through the streets.
"Look at all these mortals rushing about their lives. You must all be in such a panic to savor what little time you have, unlike us greater demons. How long is your lifespan? 5 years? Maybe 6 if you exercise."
Cole snorted and playfully poked the snake on the nose.
"You really have no idea how mortals work, do you?
I told you this is my first time visiting the Material Plane. Everything here is so new and exciting. The Infernal Plane is just a mass of pure chaos and emotion that spills over from your world. It's not exactly much to look at."
"Oh, so it's chaos and basically just the chaos realm."
"Just an eternity of stuff. Everything in the mortal world moves so fast in comparison. The people of the mortal world are always in such a rush."
Malice blinked and gestured across the street.
Like that one over there. Look at her dashing about in such a stress-filled panic. I must admire you mortals for making the most of what short lives you have.
Cole squinted at the familiar dashing individual in question. A familiar knight was rushing from door to door of every shop, begging for the attention of anyone who would listen. Their stance was haggard as they looked utterly exhausted. They clearly had been at this for a long time. The knight looked up and made eye contact with Cole from across the street.
Artemi. Had a feeling.
Cole? Oh, hey, knighty. How's it going?
Cole paused.
Wow, you look like shit.
Artemi grimaced and rubbed her temples warily.
Good morning to you as well, Cole. Forgive my appearance. I'm afraid I have been up all night performing my tasks.
Night? It's 9 o'clock now. Dazed, Artemi glanced at the sky in surprise, as though just realizing it was daytime.
Ah.
Upon closer inspection, Artemi looked like an utter overworked mess. There were dark bags of fatigue under her eyes, and her hair was unkempt and messy. She stood slightly hunched over and wore a drained expression that received little to no sleep. It was surprising that she was still lucid and in such a state. Artemi cleared her throat. Cole suddenly realized he was staring and awkwardly averted his gaze. The tension from the little argument yesterday still hung in the air as they each waited for the other to speak.
Listen. Do you want to go grab some tea with me? I know a pretty good cafe here.
I'm afraid I must decline. My duties remain unfinished and I have much to answer for, especially due to my failures yesterday.
Oh, come on, you're not going to get anything done when you're an exhausted mess like this.
A little rest does wonders for the mind. Artemis' tense shoulders slumped slightly with a hint of hesitation.
But...
hey, if you didn't manage to finish your duties when you're wide awake, you sure ain't gonna finish it when you're half dead.
Come on, it'll be my treat. I still owe you for saving my ass yesterday at the fighting ring. Finally, Artemi let out a sigh and nodded.
I suppose it would be rude of me to decline. Thank you, Cole.
The town square had a number of excellent outdoor cafes, each of them often filled with jolly company and fresh steaming tea. The customers around them were sneaking the occasional glance at Artemi and whispering amongst themselves. Perhaps it was unwise for the creators chosen to make such a casual appearance. Artemi had never been at a cafe before and shuffled awkwardly in her seat. Cole had to patiently explain to her multiple times that, no, you don't have to get up and bow at the waitress every time she comes to refill your tea. Artemi sank back down into her chair and opted to bury her face in her teacup to avoid eye contact with the all-chuckling cafe-goers around her.
Anyway, that is why I've been up and about all night since our departure at the Fighting Ring. His Highness had requested that I focus my efforts in retrieving the 4 missing rubies in his crown. And the Bishop of the Grand Cathedral insisted that failure was not an option, lest I lose my title as the Creator's Chosen.
Cole nearly snorted piping hot tea up his nose.
What? She threatened to demote you over a handful of jewelry? The prince is fucking rich, for crying out loud. A few gems is like nothing to him. What's your language, Cole? It's a matter of honor. The Creator's Chosen cannot be expected to lead the church if my history is stained with failure. I'm surprised the church would be so harsh with you. I always imagined the Creator's Chosen would be a bit more pampered and spoiled.
A hint of guilt weighed over Cole's shoulders as he finished his tea.
Tell you what, why don't me and Sid help you out on this mission of yours? The two of us need to do more adventuring work anyway. Plus, you'd have the entire Bonebreaker Mercenary Guild behind you.
My papa's, whatever. Hamish
knows his way around the city like the back of his hand.
And he's got a lot of connections, both shady and official. His network's gonna have a way easier time tracking down your rubies than you running around like a headless chicken.
I suppose you have a point.
Artemi stared at him hesitantly.
It would be unwise for me to look a gift horse in the mouth, but why are you so willing to aid me? Yesterday you gave off a rather aloof outlook.
Well, I guess I feel a little guilty. Not that it's my fault or anything, you're the one who fucked up. But I'm happy to help you out since I'm just a nice person.
Artemi looked utterly unimpressed. Cole cleared his throat and quickly changed the subject.
Anyway, why isn't the church providing you with more support on your mission? Don't you have any friends at the cathedral you can ask for help?
Artemy's shoulders slumped as she frowned at her teacup.
I never managed to make many friends at home. Everyone in the cathedral seems to keep their distance from me. Even all the townsfolk I spoke with this morning seemed a little nervous in my presence. Am I doing something wrong?
Cole rolled his eyes and signaled for a refill for his tea.
I mean, you did barge into every establishment asking weird questions about missing rubies. Of course people are going to get weirded out. Artemis' ears drooped self-consciously.
That doesn't explain why the people I grew up with in the church also feel wary around me.
It sounds pretty normal. You're the creator's chosen, after all. People are saying you'll save the world from a horrible fate or whatever. Most people would want to stay out of that nonsense.
Does my title make me intimidating?
Kinda.
But you and Sir Cid certainly did not treat me as such when we met yesterday. Well, it's kinda hard to be intimidated by a hyperventilating whelp on a jail cell floor.
Artemi took another gulp of tea with a wistful expression.
I certainly hope I did not have to be arrested every time I try to make friends.
See? Here's the thing. You're the creator's chosen one. You're all the way up here, right? Cole waved a hand above his head dramatically. The legendary hero destined to save the world or something. That's a pretty big deal. Everyone else lives down here. They're not worried about existential threats or world-saving nonsense. They're just normal city-going folks with jobs and family stuff to worry about. Artemi frowned and shuffled in her seat self-consciously.
Well, that's not very different from my own daily life.
Exactly. Sometimes it's hard for people to remember you're a normal nervous wreck just like everyone else.
I suppose I see the logic in that, though I fail to see a way to change people's minds.
Oh, that's easy. Fancy playing a card game? Artemi blinked in surprise as Cole pulled a deck of cards out of his loincloth and began shuffling it with an impressive flourish.
How in the world does he fit so much within such a tiny scrap of cloth? And how exactly did he know where to reach without looking into it? A card game? I'm supposed to be searching for His Highness's missing rubies. What will the people think when they see me shirking my duty?
They're gonna start thinking, oh look, the creator's chosen knows how to sit down and have fun once in a while.
You gotta relax sometime, right? Otherwise, you're just gonna come off as a mindless workaholic knight who only thinks about duty and whatnot. Come on, the day's still young, a game or two won't hurt.
Artemi grimaced doubtfully as Cole dealt her a pile of cards with practiced ease. She noticed several passers-by and streetgoers in the town square glanced in their direction curiously. It wasn't every day you see the creator's chosen lounging leisurely at a cafe. She collected her cards hesitantly.
I suppose a minor distraction wouldn't hurt.
Cole gave her a sly smile. You won't regret it. And then she regretted it. Artemi let out a wail of disbelief as Cole won yet another round.
What do you mean I lost again? How exactly do spades beat diamonds?
The two of them had been playing until they lost track of time. Cole had beat Artemi 7 rounds in a row without a single defeat. It was absolutely ridiculous.
Was she just really bad at this?
Artemi scowled and tried her best to look displeased, but she was clearly having fun nonetheless. The other people in the cafe glanced at their table with amusement as Artemi tossed down her hand yet again, sending cards flying into the air. Ah, so even the creator's chosen can be beaten.
Do not mock me, Cole. You only won because I am still unfamiliar with the game's rules. How in the world do you have such good luck?
Ain't nothing lucky about it. This is all skill, baby. Anyway, if we tally up all my winnings, it looks like you owe me 6 gold pieces. Pay up, knighty.
Pay up? You didn't mention this was gambling?
Card games aren't fun unless there's some stakes involved. Everybody knows that.
I see.
Oh, God, poor girl. Did she even have 6 gold pieces? Oh, holy crap, I'm bleeding. Ah, I was scratching a place on my leg. It was itchy, so I scratched it. Now it's bleeding. Damn it.
I'm afraid I don't have any money on me, however.
What? Nothing? What about that big sack of gold I paid you yesterday?
All my earnings and rewards go directly to the church. I mean, Her Excellency says that the creator's chosen should dedicate their life to the good of the world and avoid the distractions of material goods.
What? That just sounds like you're getting the short end of the stick. You should at least earn a bit and enjoy your life a little, right?
Everything you're describing about your home life just sounds kind of shitty.
Artemi glanced up defensively.
Ah, do not mistake me this for mistreatment. The church still provides me with all my necessities and needs. I'm happy how things are. The church simply leads us to live an honorable and disciplined life.
And this is the same church that you said you didn't have any friends in.
Well...
Cole suddenly felt a weight in his pocket shift. He nearly scrambled out of his seat as Malice slithered onto his shoulder with a hiss.
Greetings, shiny one. I'd hate to be a tattletale, but this puny mortal has been casting minor illusion on his cards the entire time to win.
Hey, get back in my pocket, you little shit! I knew it! Cole, you were cheating the entire time!
Artemi abruptly paused, her mind slowly processing the sight of a talking snake on Cole's shoulder.
Listen, I can explain.
Amazing! Cole, you've gone and found yourself a magical familiar. I'm happy to see you grow more comfortable with showing your magic openly. Shh! Keep your voice down! I just found this little guy sneaking into my room. I didn't summon it or anything. Anyway, his name is New.
What? That is certainly not my name! Artemi bowed her head with a grin.
It is an honor to meet you, little noodle.
That is utter humiliation! Curses!
The small python scoffed at Artemi and flourished his head foppishly.
And you! How dare you reduce me to the status of familiar! This puny mortal is now my new servant, and I his almighty master. Young lady, are you also interested in joining my horde? I am certain I can make room for one more. Although...
Malice flicked out a tongue and recoiled in disgust.
What a disgusting scent. You're absolutely swimming in celestial magic.
Cull grabbed the snake and roughly stuffed it back into his pocket.
Unhand me, you vile mortal!
Alrighty, back into my pocket you go.
Chatty little thing, ain't he?
You know, they say that familiars' attitudes often reflect the egos of their masters. Excuse you, I'm nothing like this little turd.
A small bell suddenly rang at the entrance of the cafe, signaling the arrival of a new customer. The two of them paid little attention to the newcomer until they approached their table with a cold, hard stare. Artemi felt a shadow loom over her seat. She turned around in time to meet the stern glare of her mother.
Your Excellency, but what are you doing here? I was simply passing through Town Square when I caught sight of you here. You, the Creator's Chosen, a holy knight of the church, wasting your precious time playing card games at a cafe. Did my warnings last night fail to penetrate that thick skull of yours, or are you looking forward to throwing away your title?
The entire cafe drew dead quiet. Artemi suddenly appeared very small as she spoke to the bishop in a quiet voice.
No, Your Excellency. I assure you I spent the entire night searching for the missing rubies. I was simply taking a moment to collect myself. More than a mere moment, from the looks of it. What kind of impression does this give the people of Axie when they see the Creator's Chosen blatantly shirking her duties?
Artemi gulped.
My deepest apologies. I'll see to it that this doesn't happen again.
Cole glanced between the two church members awkwardly.
Hey, ma'am, cut her some slack, will ya?
She literally worked herself to the bone all night. Everyone needs a break once in a while. The bishop shot Cole a sharp, demeaning scowl.
This is none of your business. Keep your nose away from where it does not belong.
Cole winced.
All right, geez.
The bishop returned her withering gaze to Artemi.
Really, Artemi? Why must you further sully the church's reputation by associating yourself with such questionable company? Sitting together with a man like this?
Katrina gestured dismissively at Cole as though he were a mosquito that flew into her tea. At that moment, something snapped in Artemi. Her meek expression suddenly hardened into a fierce glare as she stood up defensively.
You may question my abilities as you'd like, Your Excellency, but I will not stand for your insults towards my companions. I assure you that despite his appearance, Cole is a man of good merit.
Cole was taken aback. He waited quietly for a psych moment when the punchline finally hit, but none came. Artemi and the bishop stood glaring at each other heatedly. The silent tension hung thick in the air, with everyone in the cafe watching them breathlessly. Several long seconds ticked by that felt like years. Cole noticed Artemi's tense shoulders quiver slightly while standing against the bishop. Katrina finally spoke, her voice a low, dangerous hiss.
You dare raise your voice against the Grand Bishop in public. The nerve!
The bubbling frustration in Cole's chest rose to a breaking point. He quietly leaned back and discreetly snapped his fingers under the table, sparks of illusion magic flickering between his fingertips.
Oh my god, that is incredible. I'm gonna pause it right there. That's perfect. Oh, Cole, using that magic to your advantage, man. Oh my god. Alright, guys, thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, ring that notification bell if you're super thanks, or a tip if you can, it always helps. I'm gonna go get some soup. I love you all. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye!